You're listening to the Wedding Biz Network, the voice of the creative entrepreneur. Hey everyone, it's Andy Kushner with The Wedding Biz, in which I conduct in-depth and revealing interviews of icons and those who I feel are the next generation icons of the weddings and event industry, all to provide you with education and inspiration. And I'm excited because I just got back from New York City, where I not only saw my daughter and her boyfriend, but also interviewed, for something like the third time, Michelle Rago, destination planner. As usual, it was a wonderful, wonderful conversation with her. I'm going to release that probably sometime in October. I also sat down again with Christina Mattucci, who works for David Beam. Christina is a force of nature. Another phenomenal conversation with her as well, which I'll also probably release sometime in October. So if you missed last week's episode, it was Labor Day and there was no episode. However, the week before that, I released my interview, like a third or fourth one, with David Stark. That was on August 29th, a renowned designer and producer. And we talked about how innovation comes out of constraints and more. Every time I have David on, I get so much response. You really should check that out. Today's guest is Corbin Gurkin of Corbin Gurkin Photography. She has photographed weddings in places as diverse as California's wine country, the striking beaches of Thailand, Provence, country estates in Ireland, and the hillside villages of Tuscany. Her work has been regularly featured in Martha Stewart Weddings, Harper's Bazaar, Vogue, and Town & Country, and she's captured PDN's Top Knots Wedding Photography Grand Prize Award. Corbin shares her time between Charleston, South Carolina, Southern California, and New England. Enjoy this conversation with Corbin Gurkin. Hey, Corbin, good to have you on the show. Thanks for doing this.
Thanks so much for having me. I'm excited to chat.
Great, yeah. Well, you know, the way I want to start is that I believe you studied photography at NYU's prestigious Tisch School of the Arts, but was not necessarily planning on a career that included shooting weddings, but that you actually wanted to be a war photographer. Is that true?
That is true. I think I fought every inkling of being a wedding photographer, even though it's something that I had an interest in early on. I actually worked for a wedding photography studio before I even went to NYU. So it was definitely within the fiber of my photographic education. But when I went to art school, you know, weddings were, I would say, a bit frowned upon. It wasn't considered a real art. It was maybe more of a lucrative profession, but yeah. I really tried to fight against that.
You know, it's interesting. I'm in the band business. And when I first came to Washington, D.C., I'd been going to college in Boston. I'd had bands for years that did a lot of corporate and just public performances. And yes, someone here said, you should really start a wedding band. And I thought, a wedding band? And I thought the same as you. And then I realized, as I'm sure you did too, that we can still totally do our art within the genre, let's call it, of weddings. I mean, wouldn't you? I mean, obviously you agree because that's what you're doing.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I think, you know, for me, it was an interesting transition because, you know, you mentioned this idea of war photographer, and I was really drawn to the storytelling aspect of that. Mm-hmm. But I think that the subject matter was too dark for me, too intense, and that lifestyle didn't fit my personality. I just kept on coming back to that narrative of the wedding. And in that case, it really checked all of those boxes for me. So there were scenic imageries, there were story moments between family, there were moments that were poignant and sad at times, but also really joyful. And I think it really married, you know, no pun intended, all of the things that I loved about narrative storytelling, you know, within that space. So I decided to pursue it further.
Well, and in your site, you talk about capturing unique moments. And I love this. You say how important it is to understand what the photographs of those moments mean to a couple in the context of a lifetime of memories. Seems like a lot of pressure too at the same time.
It is a lot of pressure. And I certainly think of what I'm doing as an heirloom experience. I mean, I'm archiving a really important part of this couple's story and this family's story. So I take that really seriously, you know, but it's funny. There's so much of a focus on decor and design and the overall production of an event these days. And while a lot of my work is super high production, and a lot on, you know, the back end of things, there are weddings that I go to where they're simply just drawn to my ability to tell that story. And it may not have as much of that, you know, dynamic design around it, but they're so focused on my ability to communicate their love, their family, their experience through my images that, you know, in some ways I feel like that gets down to the real, the real meaning in what it is that I do.
Well, how do you go about discovering, you know, these moments so that you can tell that story? I mean, I know that's a big question, you know, but it strikes me like, again, it's easy for me to think about the band side of business. There's a certain amount of it that is well planned ahead of time, right?
But then
we got the performers have to have a chance to really be creatively spontaneous in the moment, given what's going on with the crowd and the couple. So, you know, I understand something about that. How do you look at it?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that you have to be really open to. I mean, I go into every wedding, and even couples will say this, you know, when we're maybe in between portrait locations and driving to the next spot, they'll say, what's the craziest thing that's ever happened on a wedding? You know, what's something wild? But, you know, weddings are inherently the same every single weekend, whether it's a huge wedding in Palm Beach at the Breakers or it's a tiny wedding in somebody's backyard. The end goal is the same here. So, you know, I think I'm certainly looking for key moments that happen in every wedding story, but I'm also leaving myself open to those spontaneous events that happen that really make that particular collection of images unique. So, It's not the first kiss. It's not the first dance. It's not the toast necessarily that makes, you know, each wedding unique, because that happens at every wedding,
right,
more or less.
You
know, it's really just making sure that you know that formula, you have that formula in mind, but you're also willing to throw it away when something really wonderful and magical and spontaneous is happening. You've got to be open and aware of the possibility of that.
God, and it's so exciting, I imagine, when you have this moment and you see it, you feel it, and then you grab it. I mean, it's just got to be the best part of the night.
It's very exciting, and especially when you just know that you captured something special.
Yeah.
I mean, I think, you know, my team they laugh at me. They say that I get this voice about me that I, you know, I'm really excited and something really incredible is happening. I think my voice changes and I'm like a little kid there. I mean, I'm also an artist. And so for me, when I feel like I'm making something that in my mind is art, that's what makes me really happy. And that's when I get excited about the process.
Yeah. Well, and I also know, you know, I understand in terms of the interviews I've done with photographers that in order to really get these moments, particularly with the couple, they've got to be able to be vulnerable, right, in front of you and feel comfortable.
Yeah. You know, I think that's true. I mean, I might approach it a little bit differently than some of my peers. I do go into weddings hoping that there's some level of connection with the couple, but I'm also very comfortable going into a wedding saying to myself, okay, so maybe this couple just isn't quite my, you know, I don't want to say my vibe, but, you know, I can't picture us being, you know, longtime friends after the wedding. But at the same time, I'm looking for something about this day that is inspiring to me. So it could be something really small, like the way that light is falling across a veil in a room, or, you know, something about the space that I'm really excited about. But I just have to look at some aspect of the day that's bringing me that inspiration. And then I'm able to wrap my head around building this collection of images off of that. So, I mean, while I do think the connection is important in the sense that I want to be a person that they're open to hanging around with, that they feel comfortable with, but I think my personality in general just lends itself to that. I mean, I'm pretty laid back. I think I'm, you know, cheerful around them. I make it a stress-free experience so that I can kind of blend into the space. But it's a lot of it is reading the room. It's knowing when they need you to be that support system, when they need you to be their good friend, but also just knowing when they kind of want to do their own thing and you're going to let that unfold around them.
Well, in terms of the planned part of it, like, can you take me through what your general process is from when you first meet with a couple, you know, and through that? Like, do you have a particular method? How do you go about that?
Yeah, I mean, so most of the weddings that I photograph are booked through a wedding planner. I would say that I meet the couple maybe 50% of the time, maybe 25% of the time. I'm not sure that that meeting process is really important to my client because they're relying on a wedding planner to curate a team for them that, you know, that wedding planner is presenting me as an option where personality, they've already vetted me. They know that personality wise, I'm going to be totally fine with this couple. They're going to feel comfortable. They're not going to feel micromanaged, you know, so that's a given. So it's really what their reaction is to my work. And when they see my work, whether or not that's on Instagram or on my website, are they picturing themselves in those images? Are they imagining what it would be like for me to capture that day for them? And that's really where my process begins. So I find that most of my clients these days, you know, they haven't looked at six different photographers or 20 different photographers. They've maybe looked at two photographers, but a lot of times they've just looked at me and they've said, we're in love with her work. We're in love with her style. We're so excited to see what she does with our event. So that's a really huge part of the process for me. It immediately builds a trust and also an excitement for me to capture those images. So I start there. Then I like to find out, you know, of course, the nitty-gritty of a timeline, you know, what the kind of ins and outs of the day are going to be. And I do want to make sure that I'm going to have a decent amount of time for aspects of the day that I think I really excel at. So that's going to be your portraits. That's going to be your scenics. You know, the rest of the event is going to unfold naturally, but I do like to make sure that there's, you know, ample time for me to capture those things. And then, you know, it's really meeting the couple on the weekend a lot of times, just kind of building a rapport. And a lot of it is also on the behind the scenes side. I typically work with a large team on weddings. So a big part of my process is art directing how that team is going to move through that event and capture everything the way that, you know, I have planned out.
But how does that go if you don't have a ton of details?
I have to have those details. So I'm going to chase those down. Oh, do you mean details in terms of the decor or?
Well, both. I guess when you're, and especially when you're doing these higher end weddings or the celebrity weddings and you're signing an NDA, but you know, more than that, like you say, you don't have a chance to meet the couple ahead of time.
Yeah.
You've got to go through the planner. I mean, I understand wanting to get the timeline. Is there anything else that's really important to you to get from a planner when you don't have a chance to meet the couple ahead of time?
You know, I do think that an important part of the process is that walkthrough with the planner. So I really do like to get on site and just be able to see the space and physically walk through the day with my team. So that's going from, you know, getting ready, figuring out what the transition movements are going to be into ceremony, into first look. As long as I feel like I have that under my belt and I have a really clear understanding of how things are going to move and how things are going to transition from one space to the next, then that's enough information for me. I mean, I know the sort of shots that I personally want to have in a collection of images. So I'm going to make sure that, you know, we have that internal checklist that, you know, I'm checking off in my brain, but I'm also having, you know, my entire team check things off as they go as well. So I feel like the walkthrough is the most important thing on the logistics side.
Makes sense. Yeah. Are you also looking, like if there's going to be shots outside, what do you do? Like, do you come back and look at the time of day where the sun is setting and all of that? I mean, how much do you?
Absolutely. I mean, I do want to make the most of best possible light. But a lot of times, you know, if you're going to push for a first look, then that's going to be earlier in the day. And in that case, I'm going to scout the space, you know, 2 days before, figure out where the light is going to be optimal at that time, you know, so it's because it's useless to do a walkthrough at 6 p.m. if your first look is at 1 p.m., it's just going to look completely different. So you really want to make sure that, you know, you have a pretty good understanding of what that light is going to look at, because the worst thing I feel like on a wedding day is having to get into a space and just say, this is not working, and have to move 20 family members to another spot. I feel like that gives an impression of not being prepared. And you really want to make sure that you're going into this as someone who understands a high production, understands that we have minimal time to make these things happen. And so in that sense, I really do like things to be very well planned out.
I want to make sure that you're aware of two other shows that are on the Wedding Biz Network. First, The Business of Being Creative, hosted by founder and president of The Business of Being Creative, Sean Lowe. Sean's consulting firm is focused on providing practical advice to those in the business of being creative. Tune in every Tuesday to hear a new episode chock full of topics and advice for creative businesses. Also, check out the two seasons of Stop and Smell the Roses, hosted by the one and only lifestyle and event design expert, Preston Bailey. Preston speaks with such an honest voice, I know you're going to thoroughly enjoy hearing him on this unique platform. You can find both shows at theweddingbiznetwork.com or on your cell phone's podcast app for both The Business of Being Creative and Stop and Smell the Roses. Corbin, one of the celebrity weddings that you're known for is Joe Jonas and Sophie Turner's, which I heard, by the way, was something like 5 days of shooting in the south of France, and there was a heat wave?
There was. We like to say that wedding was like shooting on the surface of the sun.
Oh, geez.
It has never been so hot in France, I think, except for maybe this week.
Right. But, I was going to say now.
Right, yeah. Now. Yeah, right now. But, it was really warm. And that wedding in particular, I think, was one of the first weddings where we had a very large team. And I really understood from that wedding how important my team is to me, each one of the shooters that works with me, they're wonderfully talented and they're wonderful people. But it became very clear to me that in difficult weddings, in weddings where really there is so much pressure on you to deliver, not only, of course, for the client, but also, this added layer of press needs, this added layer of security. In that moment, it really becomes your team that I think carries you through these events. And that wedding was certainly kind of the introduction to that type of experience. We had a great time on that wedding simply because it was like one of those, experiences of how would you say it? Camaraderie in hardship. It was kind of like, I can't believe how hot this is. I can't believe how wild this is, but we are in it together. With that said, they're a lovely couple and I couldn't have enjoyed them as a client more. So I think that really contributes to it as well. It can be very, very hot, but when you're working with great people, when you're photographing a lovely family, a lot of those external factors kind of fade away.
Well, also dealing with these celebrity weddings, those two, for example, Joe Jonas and Sophie Turner, they know how to have their picture taken. That's the other thing, right?
They do. They know how to have their picture taken. And so in that sense, things can happen pretty quickly. You don't have to pull so much out of a client. But at the same time, because they know how to have their picture taken, their expectation is that you're going to give them, about 5 minutes of portraits and then you've got it. So you really do have to move quickly. The process, you have to be kind of secure in the shots that you're making and the choices that you're making, because you're not going to have, let's try this location or let's walk over here. You've probably got one spot. You've probably got 5 minutes and 3 of those minutes are going to be hair and makeup doing touch-ups. So you really have to move quickly.
Yeah. Obviously I looked through your photos on your website and Instagram and both the weddings and the editorial sections. And the wedding photos are stunning and filled with so much emotion, and the editorial photos look like pieces of art. What are the differences in your approaches for each?
Yeah, that's interesting. I think that I look at editorial as more controlled. I think of it as building. I started out as a painter way back in the day. I was definitely the art kid. And so editorial, I tend to look at in terms of a painting. I look at the way light is falling across the subject. I'm kind of placing and moving a model, you know, into an environment. And it's a lot more controlled. It's a lot slower. I just think on weddings, you don't necessarily have the luxury of doing that. It's sort of an abbreviated version of that type of shoot. So, you know, a portrait session or a lookbook, I'm photographing a model in a gown for hours at a time. You know, on a wedding day, you might have 10 minutes for a bridal portrait. So it's kind of, it's an abbreviated approach, but similar, I would say, in the type of lighting that I look for, the type of environment that I'm drawn to. I mean, that's definitely a blend of styles for sure.
And how do you feel about film versus digital?
You know, I like to think of both of them as simply tools, the same way that I feel about different types of cameras. I mean, I get a lot of, you know, Instagram direct messages about, you know, what camera did you use or what lens did you use? And I don't feel any need to hide that information. I mean, I think it's simply a tool. And I think that people, you know, can make work beautifully with either. I would say that I describe myself as a digital photographer with a film sensibility. I love what digital offers on a wedding day. And quite frankly, these days with the immediate turnaround needs for both, you know, press, for celebrity weddings, even simply for clients or wedding planners who want to post things quickly, digital is a necessary option for that. So, you know, I started off in film. I love film and it'll always be part of my, you know, artistic fiber, I would say. But these days I do see digital as being a strong contender in the wedding world.
What now, Corbin, what is the hardest part of what you deal with or that you're going through now in terms of with your career and doing what you do? What's the real difficult side of this?
Gosh, I mean, I love it. I love what I do. I feel really so lucky at this point to have found the right vendors to work with, the right types of weddings to photograph. I think time is always a challenge. You know, I'm a wedding photographer. I'm also a mom, and finding the balance between, you know, work, which I absolutely enjoy tremendously and probably do too much of, and the balance of family as well. I think that that's a challenge. I definitely have a hard time saying no when it comes to work because I'm excited to photograph. I love what I do, and it's hard for me to decline a project that sounds exciting. So I'm still looking for that balance, but I do have a staff now, and that has certainly helped me to delegate a bit of the things that I perhaps don't need to be doing as much of. And that's, you know, I think that's been really helpful for the process.
Yeah. I think being able to get to that point where you can delegate and trust and take I know in my own experience, I was very hesitant in the beginning to delegate anything. You know, I wanted to have complete control, but we can only go so far, you know, doing everything by ourselves. So
it's true. It's true. And, you know, I think that we have to determine in our business, what is it that we are good at? What is it that we should be doing? And the things that we're not so great at, or that our time is more valuable, you know, I think early on, I was an accountant. I was, you know, a travel agent. I was all of these different parts of, you know, a business. And I'm not amazing at all of those. I'm really good at the photo side. I'm really good at the people side. But it's an important lesson to a business owner to figure out kind of what your superpowers are within your business and really focus in on those. Because otherwise, you're losing money if you're spending a lot of time doing those other things. I mean, I feel like my business has grown tenfold in the past few years simply because I've been able to step back and say, okay, here's what I'm good at. Here's what my team is good at. Here are what these other companies are good at that I don't need to be taking on at all. And it just feels like I'm a much better oiled machine.
Well, and also I'm thinking while you're saying this that people have to understand that it's an investment to hire people to help you, and there's the opportunity cost, which is what I hear you saying earlier too. Is what you when you say it's expensive for you to do it all, it's the opportunity cost, right? It's having someone at lower salary, lower rate, while you can go do the bigger stuff.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, and I think that that's probably what kept me from hiring extra, you know, employees for a long time, I just felt like I couldn't justify that expense. But these days I look at my business and think I can't not justify it. Yeah, I mean, right. I absolutely have to have, you know, this support system to be able to do what it is that I do. I think just too, as an artist, if my head is getting too bogged down with things that are not inspiring to me or not creatively fulfilling, then I think my work is going to suffer. And right now I feel like my work is some of the best I've ever been making. So that's something to feel proud of. And I think it's, you know, I've hit a stride with it for sure.
That's great. You know, also, I know that a part of your backstory is you had spent years in Italy and then you moved back to the States and you wanted to make your presence known amongst planners. And we're talking about networking. And so I'm wondering how, I mean, I heard this in some interview of you that you had, you knew you had come back and you really didn't know anyone when you came back and you needed to get your work out. How did you go about finding these planners and getting them to check you out?
You know, to be honest, the wedding industry is a lot different now than it was when I was first starting out and trying to make those connections. I do feel like now there are a lot more opportunities for vendors to collaborate and to meet. I mean, I know, you know, a lot of people you've interviewed have spent time at Engage as attendees, right, or speakers. I think that, you know, conferences, right, like Engage, like Hybrid for photographers, all of those environments are a really good opportunity to meet people simply because, you know, your work can speak for itself. And that's definitely what I want when clients are looking at my photography. But I found that going to more of these networking events and just getting one-on-one with vendors that I want to work with, you know, we're hanging out in a hotel lobby. They're seeing, oh, Corbin's nice. Like Corbin's a normal, easygoing person who would be great to work with. And I think that, to be honest, the personality side of things is really what separates each of us these days. I mean, there are so many fantastic wedding photographers. There are so many fantastic, you know, planners and florists. And so it's not so much, you know, a lack of work out there. It's, you know, just making sure that the personalities align. I had dinner on Saturday with Michelle Rago, and she's someone, you know, we've worked together on a few really big projects recently. She's just someone whose personality I connect with. She and I get each other. We're on the same wavelength. And I think finding those types of people to work with is what's going to be really valuable for you. So it's, you know, when I talk to younger, newer photographers or, you know, vendors in general, I say, you really have to find your people. You don't have to work with everybody. You just have to work with a handful of people who really vibe with your approach.
Yes.
And so that's kind of where I'm at in the industry. I mean, you know, I've been around forever at this point. I've been shooting weddings for 20 years. So I don't have the same need in my business to introduce myself to new people or to put my work out there. I would say my name is relatively well known within the industry at this point. So it's just making sure that, you know, if there's a planner whose work I'm really admiring, you know, I'll send them a message and say, I saw that wedding that, you know, you just posted from Napa, or I saw that tabletop that you just did for a holiday party, and I just love your style and I wanted you to know that. I think it can be so simple because people don't want to be sold. You know, they just want it to feel natural and they want you to feel normal, like you're an approachable human being. So I really do try to take that approach with,
yeah,
it.
all good points. Just a couple more questions. I know that you've had a lot of editorial features in Martha Stewart Weddings, for example. How do you approach putting together a cohesive editorial spread?
Yeah, I mean, so much of that goes back to this notion of storytelling and thinking about images that you need to be able to tell that wedding story. So Martha is a really great example. And I mean, I give a lot of credit to the connection that I had to Martha Stewart and the work that I got through there, because they really taught me, you know, what it is that's needed for an editorial story. It's an opener. It's room for copy. It's a beautiful portrait that says, this is the couple. It's a ceremony moment. It's some personalized details. And all of these images, you know, if you look at the stories that are in a lot of these magazines, oftentimes you're seeing the same formula for each wedding. So kind of having that internal checklist, I think, is really helpful. And it does allow you to build out a really, you know, beautifully fleshed out collection of images so that every aspect of the weekend is covered. And I think that that's something that, you know, if I can say what my work, how my work stands out, that is something that we are good at as a team. We get everything start to finish. Every aspect of that day is documented. So it's scenics 2 days before where I'm scouting a location and I'm, you know, capturing shots at sunset to really give a sense of place to the collection of images, but it's also, you know, all of the details in between. So I think from that standpoint, editorial has taught me that more than anything. But yeah, I really do approach that side of it as a bit of a checklist. You know, you want there to be a blend of really authentic moments with more stylized shots. And mm-hmm. I think that tells a good story.
And lastly, for the photographers listening, what is the gear that you're using currently?
Yeah, so I am mostly shooting with a Sony mirrorless camera. I have a few different Sony bodies. I have an A1, an A7IV, A9. You know, those things are ever changing. I tend to like a 50 millimeter lens, which is comparable to an 80 on a Contax. In terms of a film camera, I mean, I bounce around a little bit, but I have a Contax, I have a Pentax. But the Sony A1 is probably my main camera these days. And I just love it. I love the creaminess of the files. And I think Sony is really doing, you know, some great technology with digital.
Yeah. Well, that's great, Corbin. Well, this has been really interesting. Again, I love your work. So it's been really fun to be able to get to know you like this. And I appreciate you taking the time.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. I really enjoyed it. And it's so fun to hear how many wonderful wedding people you're bringing together. Lots of friends and people who I admire on the podcast. So great to be a part
thanks.
Of it.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you for listening to my conversation with Corbin Gurkin. Be sure to check out her site, which is CorbinGurkin.com. Her social media handle on Pinterest is Corbin Gurkin, and on Facebook, it's Corbin Gurkin Photography. You can get all of this in the show notes with event pics that our guests provided in your cell phone's podcast app or at our website, oftheweddingbiz.com. And if you can think of three good friends who you feel would enjoy this conversation with Corbin, please let them know about it. Also, want to let you know about next week's upcoming guest, and that is a return appearance by filmmaker and keynote speaker Brett Culp. We had another wonderful conversation, and this one was about embracing change, empowering others, and sparking innovation. So be sure to touch base with us next week. And if you're not yet following The Wedding Biz on your podcast app, be sure to do that so you know when a new episode drops. You can also follow us, especially on Instagram, at The Wedding Biz, and we'll catch you next week.